Hello and welcome to this week's Ebby Children at Home. It's great to be back with you. You might remember that so far this summer we've been looking at heroes of faith through the Bible, and so far we've heard about Samuel and Moses and Mary, and last week was the Battle of Jericho with Joshua. Well, this week we're looking at another hero of faith, but this lady's not even got a name in the Bible. But she's remembered because she was one of the people, one of the many people who was healed by Jesus. And she was healed because of her faith. Now, for the story this week, we're going to play Story Bingo. So for this, you will need a piece of paper and a pen. So it would be a good point now to pause the video so you can get your own piece of paper and pen. So see you in 2 ticks. Okay, so pause the video, you've got your paper and your pen, and now this is what we do for our story bingo. Just fold your paper in half, and then in half again, and then in half again. And quite wonderfully, you then have 8 rectangles that you can write your bingo words in. So I'm going to hold up your bingo words, and what I'd like you to do is write the words yourself. You can always ask your tame grown-up to help you if it's a bit difficult. But I'll go through them now. But at any point, pause the video so that you can write them on your own bingo sheet. Here we go then. Heard, thought, said, hope, did, risk, faith, and healing. So those are your 8 words. So pause the video and make sure you've written your words on your sheet. Okay, so now we're ready for the story. As you hear these words in the story, what I want you to do is just cross them off and shout bingo. You have to listen carefully and see if you can get all 8. Now, this week's story about the lady who was healed by Jesus because of her faith in him comes from both the book of Matthew and the book of Luke in the Bible. Now, Luke and Matthew are 2 of the Gospels, and Gospels are the good news stories all about Jesus. So we're going to let this lady tell the story for herself. So I'm going to open my Bible at the book of Luke, and she will appear and tell us the story. But before I do, just let's imagine the scene. It's hot. There are crowds of people, and Jesus is walking through the town. There's one lady in particular who's desperate to get to him. But there are throngs, crowds of people all around Jesus, jostling, crowding him. She can hardly see him. So this is what happens in this story, the book of Luke. Oh, wow. I am so happy. So happy I could sing. So happy I could dance. Oh, the world's a wonderful place. You're all wonderful people. I could hug you. Oh, this is the best day of my life. You see, I was so sick. I was so sick. I was dying. I'd been bleeding for 12 years and I was so weak. I thought I had no hope. I felt like giving up. But then I heard about Jesus. Someone told me that wherever he went, he would heal people. And he'd healed their cousin. And their cousin had been blind and now could see. And someone else told me that he'd healed their uncle who had been crippled. And now this man was dancing the okey-cokey every day of his life. And oh, I thought, wow, could Jesus heal me? Well, after I heard this, I had a thought. Maybe this kind and powerful man would heal me if I got close to him. I felt hope inside of me for the first time in years, and that hope was so good. But could I dare to believe that Jesus would heal little old me? Why not? If he healed others, why wouldn't he heal me? So I kept thinking. I kept telling myself, If I just manage to touch the edge of his cloak, I'll be healed. But it wasn't easy. For a start, someone in my diseased condition wasn't meant to be even out in public, and I certainly wasn't meant to touch a holy man. But Jesus was my only hope. And so I thought, I know what I'll do. I'll sneak through the crowd. I'll come up low behind him so he'll never know, and I'll just touch the edge of his cloak, and then I know I'll be healed. And no one would ever know. But the trouble was, there were so many people thronging around him. There were crowds, and I had to push my way through. And I felt like giving up before I'd even begun, because people were pushing me away and saying, get away from me, and they weren't letting me through. And it was so hot, and I thought I was going to faint. And I thought, oh no, just give up. And I thought, no, if I don't give up, there's always hope. So again, I said to myself, if I touch the edge of his cloak, I will be healed. Then at last I could see him up ahead, and I jostled my way through, and I came in low, and I just managed to touch the edge of his cloak as he walked by. And I did it. I touched the edge of his cloak. What happened next was incredible. I felt tingling go through my arm and power surge all through my body. And I felt that, life, strength, I'm healed. I knew I was healed. I was so happy. And I was just trying to melt my way back into the crowd so no one would ever know. But then something horrible happened. Jesus stopped and said, who touched me? I felt power go out of me. How had he noticed me? Oh no, I'd taken a risk and now I'd been caught. Oh dear, I froze. Well, I couldn't hide, obviously. So I threw myself at his feet and I blurted out in front of everybody, oh Jesus, I'm so sorry. It's just that I knew that if I just touched the edge of your cloak, I would be healed. I did, and I am. It was like time stood still. Would he be cross with me? Would I be embarrassed in front of all these people? Would I be punished? But Jesus looked at me and smiled. He wasn't cross. He looked really pleased. And he said, my child, you have certainly been healed. God has rewarded your faith. Go and enjoy being well. Go and enjoy your new strength. Oh, he was so kind and so pleased. And when he said that God had rewarded my faith, I knew that I'd done something that made him really happy. So here I am, full of health, full of joy. Jesus really is the healer. And I learnt today that we receive all the good things from him by trusting in him and not giving up. Hello again. I hope you enjoyed the story. Did you manage to get all 8 words on your story bingo sheet? I hope you heard them all, because these words help us to understand how faith works and how faith grows in us. The lady heard about Jesus healing others, so she thought he might heal her too. She said to herself, the truth, enough times until hope started to well up inside of her, and she plucked up courage and she did something about it. She took a risk, and so her faith put her in a position to receive her healing from Jesus. Faith is trusting God. Faith is how we receive from God. God's power is limitless, and he's so good and so kind, and he wants the very best for all of us. To connect to God's power, it's rather like this light and this plug. You see, our faith is us plugging into God so we can receive all that he wants to give us. So just like I have to plug this light into the electricity, we need faith. We need to trust God to plug into his power. and receive the good and abundant life that he promises us. Now, before we talk more about having faith for healing, Aunt Googly wants to teach us an important lesson about not giving up. Because to have faith for healing or have faith for anything means we have to keep on going. We have to keep on trusting and not give up. So let's go next door and see what fun Aunt Googly has for us today. Well, hello, my little chocolate drops. Did you notice how the lady in the story just didn't give up? I mean, she had to push past her doubts and her fears. She had to push past the crowd and get through all that heat. And because she didn't give up, she got to Jesus and she was healed. Do you know, one of the most valuable things we can learn about trusting God and about doing anything worthwhile in life is not giving up. As long as we don't give up, there is always hope. We all face hard things and we all make a lot of mistakes. But as long as we keep trusting God and don't give up, we will become stronger and wiser and get to where God wants us to be. Sometimes we have to wait for answers to our prayers. And that's when we really need the kind of faith that doesn't give up, where we learn to be faithful, full of faith. To help us remember never to give up, I thought it would be jolly good if we would make our own assault course. You can make it for your Playmobil character or your Duplo character or your little Lego person, but I'm going to make it for my favourite jelly baby. I do have ulterior motives, of course, because I rather like eating jelly babies. But whoever you make it for, it can be a miniature assault course. And let me take you through the ideas that I have for this. But you can come up with your own. Go wild. Use your imagination. Have lots of fun. Before you create lots of mess, though, make sure you ask your nice grown-up. Okay, so this is my assault course for my Agent Jelly. So first of all, Agent Jelly will have to climb the Rocky Mountain. And once he's done that, this of course is just, I'm just talking through all the obstacles before I let him loose. So he'll have to climb the Rocky Mountain. And then once he's done that, he'll have to go through the spidery tunnel. Now, if you don't like spiders, that's obviously very scary, and Jelly does not like spiders. So through he goes. This is just the dummy run, of course. And then after the spidery tunnel, he comes to the snake pit. Oh, imagine walking through a pit of snakes with no socks on, not nice. Once he does that, if he manages to survive the poisonous venom, he'll come to the shark-infested custard. Now, if you've ever had swimming lessons, I bet you've never had to swim through shark-infested custard, but that's when you get really good at swimming. So through the shark-infested custard, he will swim, and after that, if he's got any legs left, he will come to the backwards marathon run. Now, the marathon race is the longest race, and it's 28 miles. But Agent Jelly will have to run it backwards just for a little bit of added challenge. So he will run the marathon race. Run, 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 run. Run, 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 run. What's that? Your legs have turned jelly. I know, but keep going. Run, 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 run. Run, 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 run. Right, so I'm going to leave him at that one while I whiz round to make googly eye contact with you once again. Now, he is now at the evil lake of Gloop, and he'll have to wade through the evil lake of Gloop. Ooh, who knows what lies beneath that green slime. Ugh. Once he does that, emerging from the evil lake of Gloop, he will have to circumnavigate an erupting volcano. Oh, dearie me, it gets so exciting, doesn't it?
after the erupting volcano. If he's not turned to stone, he will then have one of the ultimate challenges in life. He will have to eat his peas! Not just a plate full of peas, but a whole field full of peas. Oh dear, I'm beginning to feel a bit sorry for him. But he's made of steel, this jelly baby. Oh no, he's not, he's made of jelly. But never mind, I'm sure he can do it. Then, just as you think things could not get any more difficult, he has to do his really hard sums. Oh, makes your blood run cold, doesn't it? If he survives all of that, he'll then get to the jelly baby prison. Now, if you listen very carefully, yes, they're still shouting, "Help! Help! Save us! Save us!" Will he manage to save all his friends and fulfill their ultimate destiny, which of course is being eaten by me? So if he frees them, that's the end of the Jelly Baby assault course. Okay. Okay, Agent Jelly, come back with me. I'm sure you're really looking forward to all of that, aren't you? Because we are. Right. Before I let Agent Jelly loose, there's one important task I'd like you to do to help him. You see, at every stage, even this brave jelly baby will say to himself, "It's too hard." And whenever he says it's too hard, I'd like you all at home to encourage him by shouting, "Don't give up!" And that will give him the courage that he needs to keep going. So now I've set up the course, Agent Jelly. Your mission, should you choose to accept it, is to keep going through all the dangers, the hardships, the frustrations, and the boredom of the course, and free the other jelly babies so you can all fulfill your ultimate purpose for which you were created, to be eaten by me.
Wasn't that fun?
Well, have a go yourself. Be as creative as you can be. See what you've got lying around the house and see if you can make an obstacle course for your jelly baby or Playmobil person or Lego person. You might want to copy the erupting volcano. It was jolly spiffing, wasn't it? So I thought you might like to know how to make your own volcano. Not every day somebody teaches you how to make a volcano, is it? Well, I'm just moving my shark-infested custard, so we've got a bit of space. And you will need a plate or a impressive slate like I've got, and an egg cup, and you'll fill your egg cup with some bicarbonate of soda. It's the stuff that you put in cakes to add a bit of fizz and make them rise. So I'm sure your grown-ups, well, if they're cake makers, they'll have some. If not, it's not very expensive in the baking aisle to buy some of this stuff. So fill your egg cup with your bicarbonate of soda, because this is going to act as your gunpowder, if you like. There we go. Because this is, in scientific terms, alkaline. Oh, you didn't know I knew science, did you? That's as much as I know, so I thought I'd show it off. So that's alkaline and bicarbonate of soda. So now we wanted to make a nice volcano shape, and also you might want to colour your lava. So things that you've got in the house that will be powdery and coloured. So I found some mustard powder and some paprika, because that's a nice sort of volcano colour, I thought. So mix that in. Here we go. There we go. Bit of a messy process this, isn't it? But, you get the idea. So mix your colour. I mean, if you happen to have red powder paint, that would be just the job. But not all of us have that in the house, do we? But you might have some paprika or something that's coloured like that. Right, so now we've got our coloured gunpowder, I like to call it. And then we need some flour. Here we go, flour. So you sprinkle your flour around your egg cup like so. And you build it up into the shape of a volcano, which is quite easy to do. There we go. There we are. If I had more time, I'd go and get some more flour, because we seem to be running out here, but you get the idea. There we are. Nice volcano shape. Beautiful. Now, if you really want to make it look a bit more volcano-y, you can sprinkle some pepper on the side, because that looks a bit like ash. But always ask permission. Don't want you to use up all your mum's or dad's ingredients, do we, without them knowing. And then they won't have any pepper for their eggs. They won't be pleased. So we've got volcano, but how do we make it erupt? Ah, that's the clever bit. You see, the bicarbonate of soda is alkaline. If you put acid with your alkaline, it fizzes. And the acid that we're going to use is just ordinary, smelly, white vinegar. But any vinegar will do. So shall we have a go? Shall we make our volcano erupt and see what happens? Hee-hee, I do like this bit. So gently pour your vinegar. Ooh, look at that fizz. Onto your volcano. The ultimate in acid rain, this, isn't it? And there it goes, bubbling away. Bubble, fizzy, fizzy, fizzy. I'm just going to turn it around a bit. Here we are, so it doesn't go on the floor. Don't want lava on my floor, do you? Oh, fizzy, fizzy, fizzy. And it just goes on fizzing for quite a while. So have lots of fun. Make sure that you put it on something you don't mind getting messy. So that is how you make an erupting volcano. I hope you have lots of fun trying your own.
Well, thank you, Aunt Googly. That was fun.
I've just been telling Zaza that the story that we've shared today about that lady being healed by Jesus is one of my favourite stories in the Bible. Because there was a time when I was very ill too. And just like that lady, the doctors said they couldn't do anything for me. And I tried various treatments and nothing made me better. In fact, I was getting worse. I was wanting to be a really good mummy because I had two young children. They've grown up now, big and strong. But then they were little and they needed me. And I was scared because I was thinking, how am I going to be a good mum and do lots of fun things with my children as they grow up when I can't even get out of bed? And I was so weak and so sick and very sad. But then I heard about people being healed from the same illness as I had. And I got excited. And I found out what was happening to them. And what they'd done is they'd read the stories of Jesus healing people in the Bible. And that had given them faith to believe for their own healing. And they had been healed. So I thought, oh, I'm going to do this. So I read all the stories about Jesus healing people. And just like the lady in the story, hope started rising up inside of me. And I thought, oh, maybe Jesus would do that for me. Why not? But I had to overcome lots of fears and lots of doubts. And I had to just keep on believing and not give up. And I kept on reading. And the thing that I couldn't understand is when I came to this story about this lady touching Jesus's cloak, is I thought, well, how can I touch Jesus's cloak? Because he's not here anymore. He's gone back to heaven. But then I remembered that Jesus had promised that when he went back to heaven, he would send his Holy Spirit. And his Holy Spirit would always be with us. So I thought, oh yes, so that's how I can connect with Jesus through his Holy Spirit. So I prayed that I would be healed. And I read the Bible and I thanked Jesus for his Holy Spirit and for his power. And other people prayed for me and I did get healed. And it was very exciting. And I still love to tell the story because it was one of the best things that ever happened to me. But what I wanted to add was it wasn't easy. And there were times that I felt like I could give up because it was so hard, but I didn't. I kept going, I kept believing, and I was healed. And the strength came back, all my strength came back eventually. It was brilliant. And I was able to bring up my children and do lots of fun things with them. And I'm so grateful to Jesus that he's my healer. Now, you might need healing today, or you might know someone who needs healing. And I'd encourage you to read the stories in the Bible about Jesus healing people, because that will give you faith that he'll heal you and heal those people you're praying for. Ah, that's a good question, Zaza. Does everyone always get healed? Well, unfortunately, no, because although one of God's names is the healer, and Jesus went around healing people, so we know beyond a shadow of a doubt that he wants and can, he wants to and he can heal people. We live in a very messy, broken world still. And until Jesus comes to put everything right when he comes again, we will have sickness. But we know that God doesn't change. And if he healed people in the Bible, he still heals people today. So we can trust him that as we keep on believing and keep on trusting and keep on asking, that people will be healed. And the more we pray and the more we trust, the more people will be healed. So that's good, isn't it? That's what we need to do. Yes. Right, well, we're going to pray with Funny Bunny now. And if you want to make her prayer your own, say amen at the end with her.
Hello, boys and girls. Shall we pray together? Father God, we worship you because you made us, you love us, and you want to be our friend. Thank you that Jesus was broken on the cross so we can be mended. I pray for the people I know who need your healing today. May your Holy Spirit's power touch them and make them well. Please give me faith, and may I be faithful and not give up. Amen. Okay, now, if you are feeling unwell, or if you have something that hurts, put your hand on the bit that hurts, and I'm going to pray in Jesus' name for your healing. Okay, ready? Here we go. In Jesus' name, be healed. Amen. Okay, so it's bye from me, boys and girls. See you soon. Bye.
Ah, yes, I know what you mean, Muggs. Muggs has just been telling me that it's easy to keep being scared of getting sick right now because so many people are talking about it. And when I get scared, do you know what I do? Well, I pray and I tell Jesus how I'm feeling and I read Psalm 91 and I say it out loud. And it's a psalm that I've read so often that I know it off by heart now. It's a beautiful psalm and it's full of God's promises of protection. And it reminds me that I don't have to be scared because he's always protecting me and I'm in his tender, loving care. So I thought it would be a really good idea to end today by reading Psalm 91 to you all. So why don't you close your eyes and I'll read some of the psalm and you just open yourself up and receive all the comfort and encouragement that God wants to give you. Psalm 91. You can go to God Most High to hide. You can go to God All-Powerful for protection. I say to the Lord, you are my place of safety, my fortress, my God. I trust in you. God will save you from hidden dangers and from deadly diseases. You can go to him for protection. He will cover you like a bird spreading its wings over its babies. You can trust him to surround you and protect you like a shield. So that's some of Psalm 91. Why don't you go away and read Psalm 91 or get one of your grown-ups to read it to you, especially at bedtime, because it helps you not to be afraid and to realise that God is watching over you and he loves you very much and he promises to protect you. Well, that's all from us today. I hope you have a good week and remember, keep trusting God and don't give up because he loves you. Bye.